It's an absolute pleasure to be here. Thank you for the opportunity. So we're thinking as we were preparing for the talk, it is a fantastic time to be in software development.
Think about the technology that we get to use, the experiences that we get to build, all the fancy slides we get to crib from Flickr. You know, we get to work in this amazing environment. And think about what our counterparts, maybe us, in a past life.
That wasn't too long ago. If you wanted to create a great desktop experience, this is what you'd be stuck with. And if you weren't doing that, you were doing this, which was, I don't know which was worse, actually.
But the web.
Oh, you could go to the web and create amazing experiences that were just mind-blowing.
But mobile.
Mobile. Oh, yeah. Well, that wasn't so great. And now, like, we found this random picture on the internet for the iPhone. Actually, it's taken by this guy, the photographer over here, James. But, like, the iPhone is amazing, of course. Yesterday, Brendan was on stage with some of the WebGL stuff.
Yeah.
That's really just mind-blowing what you can do, and it's not all useless demos.
Exactly. It's all real stuff now. It's just in the browser. You know, it's just kind of amazing what you can do, not only on lovely laptops in general, but in the browser itself.
And we've got job protection, right? We've run out of H-1B visas this year, so there's still plenty of jobs for people. But what's striking to us, like, not only, like, you've got, like, the job boards and stuff like that, there's the acqui-hire thing, which is really, like...
Yeah, so what I suggest, forget all of this stuff we're talking about. Grab two guys next to you, come up with a company name. There's a Facebook recruiter out there. Acqui-hire, you're all set.
You're done. $1 million. But, like, it's also striking to me how many billionaire programmers there are in the world right now. These are not like the business, these are like people who programmed as the entry in their career. Some of them just programmed and got rich. And then there's the hangers-on. There's also... There's also kind of the negative side. I don't know how many of you know who this guy is. Anyone? Nathan Mierfold, founder of Intellectual Ventures, i.e. patent troll number one. But I mean, there's always the best of times and the worst of times. I mean, the patent stuff may destroy our industry, but we're having a lot of fun right
now. It's great right now.
So clearly, we're in a period of decadence, right? I mean, it is, people are suffering in the world. We're doing great. We've got all kinds of great stuff going on in our industry. And in all of these ages of decadence, the 20s, the 80s, there's always these accompanying dilemmas that sort of niggle at the happiness that we might otherwise have, at the bliss that
might be. So the 20s, what was that? Do I live in Paris or New York?
Paris or New York? Do I write a novel or a short story? The dilemmas of the age.
What about the 80s?
Well, the 80s. Yeah, there was VHS or Betamax was one of the dilemmas. Oh. There's also Coke versus...
Heroin?
I was going to say Pepsi, actually.
Oh!
But there's that too. And for us, of course, the dilemma of our age is web or app.
Dun, dun, dun.
Dun, dun, dun. What do we do? Do we do web or app? And like, this is kind of confusing because it's actually two different questions in one, right? Do we use the web as the delivery platform or apps in the stores, or do we use it as the technology platform, right?
Yeah.
Two different questions.
Exactly. And this often gets mixed up. Is it, I'm going to use web technology and I'm just going to build these great apps on mobile and desktop using the lovely JavaScript that a lot of us here love? Or is it I'm just going to use the infrastructure of the web to just get great deployment and frictionless deployment?
So yesterday we loved listening to Nicole's talk. One of the things she mentioned was biases. As Brady mentioned, we're a little biased on the website. We spent a lot of different time in our career on web stuff. We love the web.
And part of it, I think, is just the kind of values behind it. I kind of think of like democracy. You love democracy. It's a messy thing, but it's a beautiful thing. It's like, it's protected.
Nothing at all like W3C, what working group meetings, nothing at all like this. And sometimes, though, democracy is really messy. And you look at this and you think, why can't we just have like great leaders, people who inspire us, beautiful people, like Mrs. Kate and so forth. And you look at that and you think, wow, these people are inspiring. It's not like the bickering of democracy. Let's just get our leadership from these sources. And then you kind of realize that
they're not all quite like Job.
And then you get
what happens when the king dies? What happens when the king dies?
And democracy starts to look really good when you look at it from a different perspective. Really good in some cases. And so even though we have a preference for the web, we also keep in mind the lessons of The Bridge Over the River Kwai. Has anyone actually seen this movie? This is the number one grossing movie of 1952
or something?
Yeah, way back when. Great movie. The movie, if you haven't seen it, which is most of you. It's to do with this group of British officers who were imprisoned in the war by the enemy, and they're made to build a bridge to help the enemy, and they get really into it because they're British. We'll do it right! And so they build this bridge, and they get into it. And then all of a sudden, the Allies, led by a shirtless and actually, frankly, somewhat flabby William Holden, come in and try to destroy the bridge. And Alec Guinness, the leader of the British contingent, actually tries to stop him and prevent blowing up the bridge. And then he realizes all of a sudden he's lost the ends for the means. He's sort of gotten confused. And for us, like, the ends have always been to create the best software experiences we can. We hope we can do that with the platform we love, the web, but if we can't, we still want to deliver the best experience we can to our users. So it's one of the biases we want to get out of the way. The other one is the fact that we talk about mobile a lot in this talk.
Yeah, so we definitely talk about mobile all the time. That's our background most recently, but we also think it's an incredibly critical thing as we kind of look at our juncture. And one of the important things is just kind of looking at, when you look at the iPhone, a lot of people think of it as, you know, the big revelation there is just that we've got this compelling mobile experience. But we think that there's actually more to it than that.
Yeah, in addition to liberating us from crappy mobile experiences, there's also the fact that iOS is the world's first consumer-grade operating system. And we don't really think of it in these terms, but it really is. I mean, before iOS, using a computer was a miserable affair if you weren't a geek like us. And now all of a sudden, anyone can use it. It's sort of magical. And so for us, mobile is converging with the desktop. The convergence is happening before our eyes. I don't know if the full convergence will take a couple of years or 5 or 6 years. Sometimes these things take longer than we think, but it's happening before our eyes. And so we sort of view mobile as computing itself. Obviously, the desktop form factor will always be there, but the operating system and the experience will be what we see in mobile brought to all interfaces. So that's one of our other biases. But going back to the web.
Yeah, so the web, you know, is kind of the dominant player. Mobile comes along, things are shaking up. A lot of people think, well, you know what? The web's going to win again in mobile. And so this is our old boss, John Rubenstein, talking about, hey, we've had this little experiment with apps. That's great. But we all know that the future's going to go right back to where we were, this lovely open web.
And another one of the articles we saw, native apps must die. We thought, well, this is interesting. It turns out the argument here is that it's so much effort and work to organize apps that they should just go away and you should just be able to Google things. But I don't know if this is a winning argument, but you know, I mean, you can also search for apps on your phone, and if you've seen Dion's bookmarks, I guess it's a rat's nest. I mean, it's just as bad on his browser, so I don't know, that's a great argument, but you do see things like this one.
Yeah, it's really fun to see, isn't it fun to see the business people talking about HTML5, you know, as though they know what it is, as though, yeah, any of these guys know what this is about. HTML5, this is one of our friends.
Pendulum, swinging.
The pendulum, yeah, this guy, Roger McNamee, he's got this whole post just a couple of days ago on how the pendulum is swinging from HTML4 to the apps to HTML5. No idea what he's talking about.
But VCs do, I'm sure it makes sense. But there's a sense of inevitability that, of course, the web will win. And, you know, sometimes inevitabilities don't always work out the way that it seems at the time. And in fact, as we sort of dig into this and we wonder, why is it that people think the web's going to win, we look back at why the web won the first time around. And if you look at the microcomputer revolution, which is really part of this story, there used to be a lot of different platforms, sort of like mobile used to be just a few years ago, a lot of innovation. There were fantastic platforms like the Amiga and the Mac and the Atari ST and, you know, also RANs, frankly, like the British platform there.
That's the ZX Spectrum. Anyone use that? It's fantastic. Rubber keyboard.
Not even a hand. It's not even worth it. We'll take it off the next slide. And one of these guys ran away, right? DOS got an app advantage. And pretty soon, if you wanted to run an app, you had to have DOS. And even though there were a lot of GUIs on the market, if you wanted to run the apps that mattered, you still had to have DOS compatibility. And Microsoft managed to shut out anyone that tried. And so when the competitors came in, they were forced out by this app advantage that Microsoft had accrued. But the good news is,
yeah, whenever you get someone running away and all of the users have kind of built it up onto the pedestal, they keep delivering great software.
They take care of their users, the people that put them there, with great products, time and time again. And Microsoft did that for us. But what broke us out of this thing? It was the web, right?
Yeah, exactly. So they had this dominance, and then suddenly the web comes along because all of the things that people wanted to do, it wasn't all about going into Microsoft Office and doing productivity work. It was about going to these great, amazing experiences that lived on the internet. So going into your Googles and Facebooks and Amazons and the like, suddenly I could go through a browser that happened to be able to run on different operating systems, and it broke out of the Microsoft world.
And, you know, when we gave this talk, we used to start out with these questions because You know, a few years ago when Microsoft actually made these statements, we would like put these questions on the board. We say, who said these things? And at first people were puzzled, and then we let it ride a little too long, and it got to the point where people were like, it's Microsoft! Everyone knows it's Microsoft! And so it is a group of Microsoft, if you didn't know that. Microsoft just sort of rapidly embraced the web. It was really dramatic when they did it, too. They had Silverlight and these other weird things going on. Overnight, they embraced the web because they saw what happened the first time around, and they realized, you know what, we're losing in mobile. Mobile is what matters. That's, you know, the web. The web's gonna save us. We actually made this quote up. But they went on to say it later on when they announced Windows 8. So, you know, the truth is stranger than fiction. And they got this playbook, of course, from Steve Jobs. I don't know if you remember, but the iMac, that eye in front of all of our eye devices came because when Steve came back and he needed to make the Mac relevant again, he didn't say, we've got the best operating system in the world. He probably did, but the marketing pitch wasn't, this is the best operating system in the world, we've got the best apps in the world. It was, this is the best way to get onto the internet, and the internet is all that matters. And so we've seen this pivot before, but really, is this going to save us again in mobile? Is this going to liberate us from the apps?
Right, because the web won against native before on the desktop. And surely back then, it was beating these amazing native experiences. But when you think about it, what was it competing with back then? It was actually competing with this pre-internet area of, this is what you did to get software on your PC. You'd have to walk to the store to this dude. Not the best experience in the world for a lot of people. My mom wasn't chomping at the bit to pop down the lane and grab a little bit of Ultima or whatever. But then you get the software installing it. Beautiful. So much fun installing that software.
The floppies. You remember the floppies?
Yeah, put in floppy 3. Oh, my God. Absolute nightmare. But finally, you've got it installed. You launch it. Gorgeous experiences. Just amazing stuff that the web had to beat out.
So these were the things that gave the web such an advantage, but if you look at it today, does the web continue to have the electronic distribution advantage in the app space? I don't know. Dion and I kind of debate this. I mean, on the one hand, the web, you still just go to the URL and you're there, but on the other hand, on the app side, you've got these beautiful marketplaces where you can discover things, things can be promoted, see rankings of what's popular. So often on the web, you have no idea what's popular. You just do a Google search and you've got some results, you've got some SEO crap that manages to get in there, some bot words. Well, and then if you're actually moving around and you don't have a good connection, it sucks to try and load a complicated experience, whereas if it's an app, it's just their cast. So it's not really clear as you look at all of these that the web has the advantages it used to, and then when you get the quality experience, apps have a tremendous advantage in mobile. So why would the web win again? What is the reason? And like again, you go back to this one because apps are hard to organize or whatever, but that's a pretty solvable problem when you go to all the issues that you think about, like the auto-updating problem. Maybe they're going to solve that at WWDC next week. Maybe apps are going to transparently upgrade right away. That's a solvable problem. So what are the reasons that would compel people to choose the internet and that would make the web win the second time around in the app space? And then you got this factor, right?
Yeah, like on the desktop world, Windows was an open system, so to speak, and so you could download your Firefox or Mozilla Suite or what have you and kind of get going. In the world of mobile, it's not quite the same way across all of these different platforms out there, and then you got guys like this saying, you know what, I want to make the web good enough so it's compelling for people browsing around, but I'm probably not going to want it to really match the capability of the underlying platform.
So the factors that led the web to win before, are they really there? If not, what are the new factors? But then you got this argument that, well, the web should win out as a distribution platform because of its reach. You got this massive reach. And that's a great argument. And then you sort of dig into it. This is actually a year old, but the even then we saw the trends where you look at the green line. Green line is global internet eyeballs, right? And then you've got iOS, Android, and apps, and you look at the engagement, you're, oh my gosh, how is that even possible? And then you look at mobile apps versus overall all web consumption, all footprints, and we could quibble about the actual numbers, but the trends are really clear. And the audience size you can address with apps is actually pretty friggin' massive and seems to compare fairly favorably. Then you look at some of the case studies, Angry Birds, one of our favorite. And you look at this one, and it is sort of shocking how popular and successful this has been. Sorry about the bleeds there, but it's been in mobile. I mean, it's become a massive franchise. And then Draw Something. I mean, that's like really amazing that how quickly they blew up to 1 million users. And I don't know if they've been able to hold on so well, but they've been able to blow up to 1 million users really quickly. And this is why we're starting to see increasing number of startups just decide, you know what, we don't actually need the web. We'll just do mobile, thank you very much. Flipboard being one, Path being another one, where they have some gateways into the web, but the experience is only available on mobile. I don't know what just happened.
But I mean, Flipboard. Flipboard, you could never even pull off a Flipboard.
There's no way. Actually, yeah, that's the thing. Flipboard is as a technology. There's no way you could possibly implement that in a
well, in a web browser.
Next
like
slide.
That one.
as far as reach goes, it is true. The web is the platform of reach if you care about getting to these kinds of platforms, where you could actually run it in a browser there and on BlackBerry. So if these ever become relevant, that's a great reason.
You're ready. You're ready.
You've made the investment, and you can go. So if you do apps, though, like, let's follow that line of reasoning for a second. Hang on for a second. Like, really? Is this really the way we want to develop software to do things multiple times? I mean, it's a Tower of Babel, right? Like, you've got Java, you've got Objective-C, and you've got all kinds of other stuff. That's kind of miserable, right? And then if you actually decide to do that, we're over at Walmart, and we've got a bunch of different apps on a bunch of different platforms. And even if we manage to maintain those code bases, you got to remember that, like, maybe we had Windows Phone 7 someday. That's just the US. If you're in a business with international footprint, you've got all these other code bases to maintain, and you've started to really create this massive amount of code you've got to maintain over time, and you've got to figure out ways to grapple with it. It sort of feels like solving a Rubik's Cube sometimes, except a really difficult Rubik's Cube to maintain all these different code bases and keep them in line. And then you've got this sort of moral wrongness of it all.
Yeah, it just drives you nuts. So you've built this really great experience.
Great content, right?
Amazing content, prime time, great audience, making all this money. Then you got to make the DVD. Oh man, the cast isn't available. They're doing other things. You got to recast it. And then what about the platforms that don't matter that much? These poor suckers. You get like the third level cast.
I mean, it's ridiculous, the sort of world where you have to recreate the content just to choose a new distribution channel. I mean, that doesn't really make any sense. And that's where you sort of get to, like, maybe the web can save us if we look at the web as a technology platform instead of a distribution platform. And then maybe there's something here that can sort of bring us all together. And it's sort of like,
I like that our unicorn is a little bit fatter, I've got to say. I like that.
And it even puts a smile on the droid's face if we could pull this off. And as we look at HTML5 as a technology platform, it actually has some really compelling advantages as a technology platform over native. And just stepping through those, I mean, the first one, you know, Brendan talked about yesterday how Java doesn't work, but like the web is a pretty fantastic virtual machine if you look at it that way. We don't have bytecode, sure, but we've got a fantastic VM that's available pretty much everywhere. Even Microsoft's VM ain't bad if we look at it that way. So that's actually really a fantastic thing about the web, is we've got this fantastic environment. And then, you know, distribution apps have these stores, but the web is a pretty compelling advantage here too.
Yeah, once you come from a company that's used to continuous deployment like Etsy, Facebook, et cetera, you kind of get stuck when you're in this world where it's like, wait, I've got to do a version, a release, that I've got to go through an app store. Like, this is crazy. This isn't the way I work. I want to be able to carve out 5% of my users, give them experience, do A/B testing. It feels like you're going back into the Stone Ages.
Oh, absolutely. And like, once you do have continuous deployment, you can do A/B testing. We talked about on our website function source, which we update all the time, how Netflix does great A/B testing stuff. URLs, we forget about how wonderful URLs are, but the fact that you can direct people anywhere in an app is fantastic. Never abused. It's always a great, great thing. And then the ecosystem, right?
Yeah, one thing that you can't sniff at, you know, the other platforms like iOS, you've got your single ivory tower, so to speak. In our world, we've got this amazing ecosystem. Throughout the whole conference here, we've just seen great innovation coming all over from all over the world, and we get to benefit from that innovation. We get to benefit from that collaboration. That's a massive
win. The people's platform,
the people's,
if you will. The people's platform. And then Leah, right before us, talked a little bit about this notion of, like, hey, sometimes you want a fat server, sometimes you want a skinny server, sometimes you want a sexy guy serving you things, or whatever that was. And when we did a little startup that we did right before Walmart bought us and brought us in, we created this technology for function source that we call conditional tier rendering, where using Node.js on the back end, you can decide conditionally for each page, hey, you know what, I want to render this page on the server. Maybe I want to render it on the client. Maybe for this device I want to render it on the client. Maybe for this device I want to render it on the server. And we think that's actually a compelling advantage of the web and something that people are just starting to explore that's really game-changing.
Yeah, and we just saw with Twitter releasing their new Twitter that they went back to the fact that, you know, it's not a great experience for users to come to a permalink for a tweet and just see a spinner. Let's just serve them that content and then let's add in the app UI later.
So it's fantastic, conditional tier render. So the web as a technology platform has some interesting advantages. But then when you compare them against the app stuff, it starts to get a little fuzzy again, because, you know, we talked about the ecosystem of the web and stuff, but what's so great about native is, like, there's a single place you go with fantastic documentation that just tells you how to do it. And it sort of solves this paradox of choice problem where you're like, which is Zepto, jQuery, what framework are we using today? Somebody help me decide. Whereas it sort of reminds me of the old Java days, right?
I know. We used to have the same things with the enterprise Java stacks and the different web frameworks.
Tapestry versus GSS.
I know. Struts versus this. We do Hibernate, JPA, all of these different things. When you'd look at the .NET guys on the other side of the room, they're smiling. They're happy. They're just coding away.
9 to 5, go home. Hey, what's for dinner?
Maybe play with the kids.
Wherever they're slaving away, reading books. Got to figure it out. And then, of course, there's the elephant in the room, like the UI on native is just like, it's not only is it really impressive, but it's really difficult to emulate if you're trying to come at it from a different direction. And let's be honest, you go to a De Niro movie, you want to see De Niro. You don't want to see this other guy who's pretending to be De Niro, right? You want to see De Niro. And you see the other guy, you're pissed off, like, supposed to see De Niro. There is a way around that. You could just create immersive UIs.
Yeah, and we're seeing that more and more, and that's just kind of a general trend that we noticed in mobile is that people kind of started with the stock platform, and now they're moving to these beautiful immersive UIs that can kind of go around the platforms a little bit more.
And so maybe that's the answer, right? We just use HTML5 as a technology platform and create immersive UIs. We don't try to pretend we're De Niro when we're not, and that would work really, really well if it weren't for our friend, Mr. Android. Mr. Android.
People love, don't you love doing mobile web development for Android? Isn't that just a real pleasure? Like, everyone's complaining. It's the IE6, but worse. It's more fragmented. I can't tell you the amount of time we've had to spend with like focusing issues and just like not being able to handle pseudo active. Like, it is a nightmare. iOS is beating it, but does it really matter?
Well, you know, so to create the best possible experiences on native on mobile, you really have to do native, but you can create great experiences with HTML5 if it weren't for Android, and Android sort of pulls you down into sort of, well, it's good enough with a lot of work. And you can kind of ship that, and if you're a superstar, maybe you could fork the experience and manage both. But sometimes you wonder if the good enough thing that you do for Android, you know, grandma don't care, right? She just wants to buy something. She doesn't care if it's fancy or maybe it is good enough. Maybe that's, and to be honest, how many of us are creating great, you know, consumer apps? How many of us are stuck doing, you know, enterprise crap? So maybe it's okay, right? And so, like, and there again, like, if you do all that, you get to these guys again.
And so the other piece is, when people talk about UI, they often think that it's Apple weenies wanting shiny buttons and the like. But really, it's all about the actual experience, the user experience itself. And you look at Windows Phone, and it's all about these fancy tiles that move around and laugh at you. It's not about the same kind of immersive experiences that we're used to elsewhere. And just last night, there was this big kind of flame up all about the fact that Errol Belkin talked about how you can't just make it work on all these different platforms. It just doesn't feel right. And then other people saying, I disagree. All I want to do is grab PhoneGap, take my web page, throw it out there. Who cares about if all of the transitions are the same and if we, you know, handle the menu key correctly and all of these different things? And so it's a very contentious debate at the moment.
And you see how other people have handled it. Like, if there's one company that surely would make a bet on HTML5 and mobile, surely this is the company we can all look to that says, yes, it should work. You can make it work. It's Google, right? And what has Google done? Google is actually trending towards native again. They just released Google+, the new client. Fantastic native iPhone app. And you look at and Google Search on iPhone is also native. You look at the app that isn't native, Gmail, and it's not that great. Although some people say, no, it's good enough. But there are some interesting examples that are compelling, like LinkedIn. LinkedIn is an example of how it has this great native experience in the app, but they've managed to hybridize it. They've managed to create, this is all three platforms, mobile, Android, and iOS. They've managed to share elements that are web, but wrap it in a shell where they bring native to bear and sort of use the best of both worlds. And that's actually a really interesting solution. And it's one that we've also done at the Walmart, where we are, where we've done our shopping cart in native.
Yeah, so most of the app is native when we need the experience, but we have a bridge, PhoneGap S, that allows us to tie into native UI. In the checkout experience, we need to be able to change that at any time. So here, the same code base is actually running on Android or iPhone. Android, you just can't have much of a curl around the edges.
And we also throw the iPad in there, too.
Yeah, iPad, exactly the same code base. just different CSS and the like. We get to leverage that same investment, make a change to the checkout flow, it appears in all of the different experiences.
And we created some frameworks to facilitate, well, actually not facilitate the bridges so much, but just to make the web stuff better. I don't know if we want to mention Thorax and...
Yeah, Thorax is something that sits on top of Backbone. We have a new version coming out soon that makes it even easier, adds some of the Ember goodness, and enables you to kind of do this native stuff in an interesting way.
And how much does Thorax cost, sir?
It's free and open source.
It's both.
And Lumbar is something, this build server that takes a lot of the best practices that we've heard about over the last few days, things that Paul were talking about, things that Steve had talked about, and just bundle specifically for these different mobile devices and optimize for performance.
But on the hybrid side, there's one sort of downside. And the downside is now when you want to release something, when you want to release a new iOS, when you want to release a new Android, I remember the first time the team was like, wait, if we want to make this one change in the checkout, we got to talk to the HTML team? What's their schedule? How do we... So that is kind of a downside. So... It's time to wrap up. Is there a light at the end? We talked about a lot of confusion, a lot of different trade-offs. What's going to make this better? I don't really know. Thank you very much.
We're not quite done.
There are some interesting solutions on the horizon, but Titanium may save us. We are out of time, so I'll just mention Titanium briefly, but that's an interesting one. We use JavaScript to wrap the native toolkits.
Yeah, and PhoneGap, we're actually really excited, not about the just wrap it up, your mobile website in an app, but in the really interesting work they're doing on the native side to enable you to go in on the native application that you're in and enhance the UI where it makes sense to deliver that top quality experience, but leveraging your JavaScript for the business logic.
And then we're seeing some interesting forks of PhoneGap, which is now called Cordova, the open source version that actually wrap the native toolkits, which is interesting. But to conclude, two quick thoughts. When we were at HP after they acquired Palm, one of the things we wish they would do is take WebOS and make it into a portable WebKit distribution that you could run on any platform. Because if we had one consistent WebKit renderer, wouldn't that solve a lot of our problems? And so that's one thing that we would love to see. I don't know if we'll ever see it from HP. Maybe Chrome will be that someday for us, a portable WebKit target that's actually somewhat consistent, that becomes something like Flash, but based on HTML standards. Will Android get their act together? Guys, it's taken ICS 7 months to get the 5% market share. It still doesn't fix most of the problems. It fixes some of the problems, so it's a long ways out. So to answer our question, how do you choose? Well, how do you choose between Paris and New York, right? How do you choose between Coke and Pepsi?
Pepsi.
How do you make any of these choices? Very nuanced decisions. If anyone tells you they have the answer in any sort of a general term, they don't know what they're talking about. These are very context-specific decisions that involve lots of trade-offs. We've placed our bet in a certain way. A lot of different industry people have gone in different directions. Very complicated decisions. We hope we've given you some context to help you make these decisions. And this time, we are done. Thank you so much.
Thank you.